Okay, let's make a start. Let me start by wishing you all welcome in this plenary symposium with the title Celebrating 100 Year of Insulin, Highlighting the Gains in Diabetes Longevity and Physical Fitness, a Century After This Landmark Discovery. My name is Anton Wagenmakers, and I'm Professor of Exercise Metabolism in the Research Institute for Sport and Exercise Sciences at Liverpool John Morris University. My co-chair is Professor Christoph Stettler and is leading the Diabetes Research Center at the University of Bern. His clinics are dealing both with sedentary and recreationally active people living with type 1 diabetes and also with elite athletes with type 1 diabetes. This afternoon, we have two lectures for you. The first will be given by Professor Sherry Goldberg. She is Professor Emerita at Old Dominion University and is one of the world leaders in type 1 diabetes research. Sherry also is the first author on the most recent position statement of the American Diabetes Association, and she has written a popular textbook with the title The Athlete's Guide to Diabetes. Her research and publications are important literature for people living with type 1 diabetes who are aiming to improve their general health and fitness. The title of Prof. Goldberg's lecture is The Secrets of the Longest Living People with Type 1 Diabetes, Evolving Roles of Insulin, Diet, and Exercise on Health and Fitness Over the Last Century. The second lecture will be given by Dr. Sam Scott. Sam completed his PhD in the School of Sport and Exercise Sciences at Liverpool John Morris University, and it was a pleasure for me to be part of his supervision team. After a stop as postdoc in Canada in the lab of Michael Riddell, Sam has joined the group of Prof. Stettler at the University of Bern. The title of his presentation is The Professional Athlete with Type 1 Diabetes, Applying Knowledge from Clinical Research to Improve Performance and Health in this Unique Group of Athletes. The two lectures will be followed by a question discussion session between the presenters and the chairs. This implies that there will be no opportunity, regretfully, for the audience to submit questions. And we do this to make sure that we end in time for the last prize awards and the closing session. Feel free, though, to send urgent questions that you may have either to the presenters or the chairs. Okay, so let's make a start. So over to you, Sherry, to start your presentation.
Thank you so much. Let me get going here and okay. Well, hopefully everybody can see that well. So I get to talk a little bit today about a topic that's near and dear to my heart, which is the secrets of the longest living people with type 1 diabetes. I actually wrote a book about this over a decade ago, and during that time, I was able to interview a number of people who had lived for an extremely long period of time with type 1 diabetes and learn really what they had to say about that, as well as myself, since I also have type 1 diabetes. So I'm going to start with an overview of how insulin use has changed, as well as glucose monitoring. What are some of the optimal ways to manage diet and exercise training when people have to use insulin? And what are some of the challenges of doing physical activity with insulin? Most of the pictures I have in my slides today are active people with type 1 diabetes. So just starting with a bit of background, so I'm not sure how up to date all of you are on everything that has to do with diabetes. Basically, well, we've all heard blood glucose or blood sugar. I prefer to call it blood glucose because there are so many different sugars out there, simple sugars and so forth. But so glucose is one of our three simple sugars. Most of what we end up with in our blood comes from the food that we eat, but it also can be produced by the liver. So it's really important that our blood glucose is always maintained at an ideal amount, because our brain uses it, our nervous system uses it. Now there's some alternate fuels like ketone bodies that can be used, but primarily if you don't have enough glucose in your blood, then you get all sorts of symptoms associated with having hypoglycemia. So when the things in the body are that important, we usually have redundancies that we know with glucose raising hormones, we actually have five of them that are listed here. When it comes to ways to lower blood glucose, we only have one hormone. So the body is really more focused on making sure that we have enough glucose to function well and not so focused on what to do if there is too much of it in the bloodstream, as there often is in diabetes. So insulin is released from the beta cells of the pancreas, which you can see here, the pancreas kind of highlighted in red. It is the only hormone that lowers blood glucose, but it also does other things. It's an anabolic hormone, so it promotes the uptake of fat and storage of fat. It promotes the uptake of amino acids and building of protein. So those are all important functions that it does as well. Just generally not going to talk a lot about diabetes other than introducing the types, but it is a worldwide problem right now but there actually is a bigger increase in the number of people with diabetes relative to the increase in the population. So that's both type 1 and type 2. You can see by 2045, it's been estimated by the International Diabetes Foundation that there'll be more than 700 million people around the world that have diabetes. So we're going to mainly talk about type 1 diabetes today, although there are many people with type 2 diabetes who end up using insulin, taking extra insulin. But this is a small percentage of the total. And what really characterizes this is loss of the ability to make adequate amounts of insulin from the beta cells and through what is believed to be an autoimmune process. And it used to be called a juvenile onset because it happened often in kids, but it is, and the onset is actually most common during adolescence, but it can occur at any age. And I have met people who have developed type 1 diabetes in their 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, pretty much every age. So anybody who has type 1 has to replace insulin, and there are a number of ways to do it, which I am going to talk about. Type 2 diabetes is the remainder of the cases, and again, they still produce much of their own insulin, but they have some loss of insulin production over time. They also are very insulin resistant, and so they can't make enough insulin to overcome that. The onset is more common in adults, especially older adults, but it has become more common in youth. So let me talk a little bit about insulin, and I put this really big needle here because from what I've heard of stories, who had diabetes in back in the 1920s, the needles that they used to give it were horrible, big, long, horrible things, not anything like what we have nowadays. So originally, insulin it's been around, but they discovered this extract from pancreas, and they first tested it in dogs, giving it back to dogs that no longer can make their own insulin because they took the pancreas out. So there's a picture of Marjorie and two of the discoverers, Banting and Best, won the Nobel Prize. And it's been 100 years this year, which is why we're having this symposium. So the first human patient was finally treated. So 1921 was when it was discovered. 1922, first person was treated. Then it started to be commercially available in 1923. And I actually did speak with one woman who lived in Washington State, who's passed on now, but she had been taking insulin since it was commercially available in 1923. She was she'd had diabetes for 83 years at that time, which was just amazing. So originally it was beef pork made from extracts. We have alternate ways to do it now. And as you can see, by 1926, it got disseminated, and it was treated as a cure because people with diabetes, before insulin was discovered, were dying these horrible deaths. So these are some before and after pictures of people who were suffering from diabetes right around the time that insulin became available, and then they were treated with insulin. So this is like before and after. So the only way they had to treat it at that point was a strict diet. It was practically a starvation diet because any food that was eaten required insulin in order to process it, particularly carbohydrates. So the way that it was managed was to have them not eat. So insulin was touted as a miracle cure because you could see the differences in these people. Interestingly, in my own history, I found out recently that some of my relatives, my grandfather's uncle and my grandfather's two first cousins all died from type 1 diabetes in the 1910s, right before, they were about a decade too soon. So that a whole family was basically decimated from not having insulin available. So you could see why it was really considered to be a miracle cure. So you see here that there's been some change, and I've had diabetes since 1968, so I'm aware of many of these changes as they came along. So at first it was just one type of insulin, and then they figured out how to make insulin so it lasted longer. Then they learned how to make it synthetically so it was more human, because people would have reactions to the beef pork type of formulation. Then they developed insulin pens that made it a little bit easier to give them with a syringe, and then insulin pumps. Commercially, they started out really big, and then they've gotten to be really small and easy to use. Insulin analogs, which are basically a slightly altered insulin so that it's absorbed more quickly from the skin. And they tried a whole bunch of series of insulin islets, so transplants the islets of Langerhans from the pancreas. But people have to take immunosuppression with that, so that's always been an issue. And then the insulin pumps paired with continuous glucose monitoring, trying to come up with these closed loop systems that can manage diabetes for us. So now we have a lot of different choices on how to deliver insulin, and I don't intend to go through this full list, but just to give you an idea that they differ in terms of their onset, when it peaks, and how long they last. And so most people nowadays are doing a combination of some kind of a shorter acting insulin to cover meals and a longer acting insulin to cover the body's basal needs and overnight. And we have a variety of ways to do them. Injections, which is what we've had for a long time, but the needles are a lot smaller now, so which is nice. We have insulin pumps that can be programmed. There's actually one that's also tubeless that kind of sticks just on the skin. It's about the size of half of a strawberry. And then we actually even have inhaled insulin in one brand that I know a number of people use that is absorbed really rapidly through the lungs. But just to kind of go through what some of it's been like. So this urine monitoring, I remember doing this when I was a kid. You would take a test tube, you put in, this is probably my early beginnings as a scientist, put 10 drops, 5 drops of urine, 10 drops of water, so you had to catch your urine, and then you drop this tablet in here, and it would turn some icky color between blue to this vibrant orange, and in which case it means you had more sugar in your urine. And for me, it was like instantaneous bad feedback when I was a kid, like, oh, you've been bad. Look, you've got so much sugar in your urine. But we didn't really have ways to manage it. We didn't really know what our blood glucose was. We didn't know, we couldn't adjust our insulin doses. They were the same every day. You had to take them at the same time and eat the same thing. And then you could have hypoglycemia, maybe have a low, and then it would show that you had sugar in your urine. So it really wasn't very effective. So we moved on from that to dipsticks, where you just dipped it in there and it gave you colors. And then there were ways to, you could actually prick your finger with something that looked like a bit like a guillotine like that. And it would hit your finger, and then you put it on this thing, and then you'd watch the colors change, and it'd give you a range of what your glucose was, you know, between 5 and 6 millimolar or something. Mine's in milligrams per deciliter. But it wasn't really very accurate, and I never used that to change my insulin doses. Now, this is a picture of the very first insulin pump. So it was huge. It was like a backpack they were around. And then this was a glucose monitor that when they got a little smaller to carry around, and they got even smaller. And then they've gotten to, like, this is one where it's an intermittently scanned one. It gives you a number right away. And then they haven't come up with this yet, but they've been trying to do one that's non-invasive, all sorts of different ways, contact lenses and so forth. So we don't really know where we're going to be able to do all of this. But just to kind of recap then, so now we have these blood glucose meters where you can take a finger stick glucose, get a single point in time, know what it is right then. Or we've got ways that we're using a continuous monitor where it gives us trends and alarms and so forth over time. We can see how it's doing, whether it's going up or down. And then we have ways of monitoring overall. That's another one that's on the arm. And then we have ways of monitoring it where we get an average over the last 2 to 3 months. And really the A1C, the hemoglobin A1C really tells us what we did the last 4 weeks more than anything, because the glucose will stick to a certain part of the red blood cells. And it has to do with the turnover of the red blood cells, but it gives you an idea of how you've been, but not really how you've gone up and down and so forth. We're getting even farther along with these integrated systems of using a continuous glucose monitoring and a pump. These have an algorithm that's driven by a sort of like a little mini computer. You still have to usually put in your meal boluses, and you have to announce exercise or do an override to get it to do what you want it to do, to have less insulin in your system when you're exercising. Here's some systems that are out right now that are actually these hybrid closed loop systems. And what we can do with these is we can set a glucose target of where we'd like it to keep us. And then we can see how we do in terms of time and range and getting at that target. And I think you can do time and range with any kind of a continuous monitor. You don't have to actually have it linked in with an insulin pump, but getting there. Not, you know, there's some problems, especially when it comes to exercise, on trying to figure out how to make the insulin, because insulin's delivered differently. So it's delivered under the skin instead of directly into the portal system for the liver. So you don't get the same response that you do when it has to get absorbed from under the skin. So it's really harder to get rid of it. So that part of the problem is why you have to really work hard to optimize it. Now this guy, I met him when he was already almost 100 years old. He was doing the Senior Olympics from 95 and beating all the Olympic records. He was competing against no one, but it was because he was competing against the standing records. And he was competing in those and lived to be 102 and a half, just an amazing guy. Developed type 1 diabetes in his 50s. So the key things that we have to worry about are balancing out our blood glucose levels so we don't go too high, too low, and also managing performance with making sure we have enough fuels available for the body to use. Now, every athlete has to worry about this, but people with type 1 diabetes get to be really good at understanding this because they have to in order to do it. So I was going to go back a little bit of history showing how did diet and exercise affect this. This is back from before there was insulin, where somebody was observing that when he would go out and row on the river for half an hour after lunch, he wouldn't see any urine in any sugar in his urine when he tested, even though he was eating lots of carbs, potatoes, and bread. But if he ate potatoes and bread without exercising, then he would have sugar in his urine after the meal. So we already know that somehow we're using some of this up when we're exercising. I was also going to mention the diets that were out back then. If you look at this, a lot of times what was really restricted was carbohydrate intake. So here you could eat eggs and cream and bacon and butter and meat. And then you had to worry a bit more about these things that actually had any carbohydrates in it. And what happened was most people put on a quote unquote diabetic diet, had carbohydrates restricted, which is kind of funny because we're almost cycled back to that now for many people. But that's where we started out, where they were seldom taking in more than 100 grams of carbohydrate per day. And then they were looking at, I remember when the vegetables were considered 3% and 6%. This says 5 and 10%, but same idea. Now, in terms of managing diet, we do the whole spectrum. I've met people on the keto diet, low carb diets. This is kind of what the ADA, American Diabetes Association, recommends, where it's all balanced, and people are vegan and so forth. So I think the key really for living well along with type 1 diabetes is not that you have to eat a certain way, it's that you really should eat healthy foods just like anybody else who wants to live a long time. And we know in particular carbohydrate really matters to how well we perform. Regardless of what we're doing, carbohydrates are a primary exercise fuel, and anybody who's exercising can hit the wall or bonk if they run out of stored carbohydrates and muscles, glycogen, and if you get hypoglycemic, which I've seen athletes do this doing marathons who didn't have type 1 diabetes, it certainly can happen to anybody, but more likely to happen in someone who has to manage insulin exogenously. So training and performance can be impacted by lows. And again, all these things are things that you really want to perform, you avoid when you're exercising. You don't want to have to stop. You don't, I remember one guy would tell me he could tell he was getting low because he'd be running along and all of a sudden he'd kind of start kicking the back of one foot with his other foot because he started losing some of his coordination when he was developing hypoglycemia. So when it comes to energy systems, we have these three. One is just the ATP that's stored immediately in muscle, or that can be immediately replaced with creatine phosphate. We have the lactic acid system, and then we have the aerobic system. And what we generally get when we are doing more than 5 minutes is we're somewhere in this range here. We have a mix of fuels of glycogen, like glucose and fats and so forth. But what this figure doesn't show is that it also is very intensity dependent, so that when we're at a higher intensity, even 65 to moderate to intense, we use more carbohydrates, and particularly carbohydrates already stored in muscle as glycogen, but we use some blood glucose, and that goes up with the intensity. So anytime you're doing anything that's moderate or higher, you're depending on carbohydrates as a fuel. So what happens if you're on a low carb diet? Do you have those available? It appears that you do mostly, but I'll let Sam talk a little bit more about that too. But there's very little glucose in the blood when you're doing any type of activity. I mean, just a normal person only has about 5 grams, and 5 grams, think about reading a food label, they're 15, 20 grams of carbohydrate in a piece of bread. So 5 grams is not very much. However, when we're recovering or in between bouts of exercise, recovering from, we're primarily fueled by fat. So we got to keep all that in mind. We're trying to balance this all out. Most people are going to have to take in some food depending on how long they're exercising, but even athletes who don't have type 1 diabetes have to take in food when they're exercising for an extended period of time. And you may need to start to take in more before you exercise, and you have to adjust it on what your starting glucose level is, how much insulin you have in your system. And then you may want to snack during an activity to prevent hypoglycemia. I did a survey a few years back ago, and then this got published as part of the results of just what do active people who use insulin do in terms of their carb intake. And this was self-reported. So the majority of them do, some do like kind of unrestricted, some do moderate, and then the rest do low or very low. But most of people are somewhere in the middle. I mean, it's like there's no right or wrong way. And what we found too is in terms of the amount of carbohydrate that people are taking during different activities, this primarily looks at running, cycling, so skiing and some other things here, but you can see that there is some carbohydrate intake. And this is based on body weight for almost all these activities. It's almost impossible to do any of these without taking in some carbohydrate during the activity. So we've known for a long time that I mentioned that exercise can have an impact in that early one. This is one of the earliest people I had heard of who had an athlete with type 1 diabetes. He was a Philadelphia Flyer, Bobby Clark, who played hockey. And so this is one of the earliest studies, reminding me of some of the stuff I did on myself when I was younger, when I would measure, when I finally had a blood glucose meter, I thought it was really interesting. And then they looked at the effects of exercising with insulin or with no insulin. And this is with no insulin. And when they gave insulin, the exercise dropped their blood glucose like this. And all of us who take insulin have experienced that. And that's because of this. So at rest, the main mechanism we have to get the glucose into muscle is insulin, whether it's injected or your body makes it yourself. But during exercise, we have insulin, which can cause glucose uptake, but we also, the muscle contractions themselves, there is a separate contraction-induced mechanism for the uptake of glucose. And we know from studies in the 1990s and early 2000s that these two things are separate but additive, which means that, I mean, the good news is if your glucose is high and you want to get it down, if you go do some moderate exercise, it's going to come down if you have some insulin on board. But the bad news is if you have too much insulin and you're doing the same activity, then your blood glucose is just going to plummet. So the amount of insulin that's circulating in the blood during an activity is going to be really important to know. What the body would normally do without diabetes is it reduces the amount of insulin that's being released because you don't need it, because you have the contraction mechanism. So here's some interesting data that show that insulin levels are actually impacted by exercising. And in all these cases, the insulin levels actually went up during exercise, which is the opposite of what you want to have in a physiological response. And that's because of it gets absorbed more fully and then circulated around from the skin during activity. And that's you're going to have to work on trying to minimize that impact. And you aim for an optimal level, and the range is somewhat large. I mean, it's not like you have to be a certain level. It kind of depends on how much insulin you have on board and how long you're going to be exercising and what you're going to be doing. But most people have told me that they start out somewhere in a range like this, depending on the activity. And so we can do things to prevent hypoglycemia, knowing the risks. So if you're doing something that's new or you're not used to, you actually are going to be more dependent on carbohydrates than normal. Again, I mentioned the circulating insulin. So you can do things to reduce the amount of insulin with dosing, especially mealtime before, or even with the basal insulin, increasing your carbohydrate or food intake, doing things to prevent lows after exercise. And then there's some interesting studies that have been done on using sprinting and other things where a high intensity exercise can release a lot of the glucose raising hormones quickly and help you prevent a low during exercise. And so I'm just giving you some quick ideas here of things that can be done. This is a recent study too by Jesse Zaharieva, who actually looked at suspending insulin pumps before and reducing the basal amounts. So all of these basically show that if you leave it normal, you know, your blood glucose drops more. If you reduce the amount of insulin, it's going to drop less. It makes perfect sense. So we have a number of ways to treat it. I always push glucose. A lot of people don't like glucose tablets. They used to taste like chalk. I can tell you the first ones were really, really horrible. So now we have flavored ones. They're not nearly as bad. But there are a lot of other things that contain glucose. Glucose is fastest because that's what you're trying to replace. So I think in the United States, we have Smarties that also have glucose. I forget what they're called elsewhere. A lot of sports drinks, they have glucose polymers in them. People need to check and then they need to treat it. And we also have glucagon for rescue. And usually that's just been used when people are unresponsive or can't treat them, self-treat. This nasal one is actually pretty new that's been released in the last couple of years. And they're also working on little mini doses, like little pens that can give glucagon that's going to be the thing that helps your liver release glucose. So I'm going to finally finish with some quick challenges and benefits to being active. I don't have enough time today to go through all the factors that it can impact how your body responds on any given day, but just know that there are a lot of them. And this is kind of a short list. So it's good to know that there are many different things. I mean, if you're exercising at altitude or if it's cold out, it's going to have an impact. Air pollution even has an impact because it changes, it makes people somewhat hypoxic, which increases blood glucose use. I was going to mention a couple things. So we know that some of the problems we have nowadays is that our current methods to deliver insulin don't replicate what we see normally physiologically. As I mentioned, the insulin is delivered under the skin. It's not delivered where you ideally would want to have it, which is at the level of the liver. And this can impact how well we store glycogen, which is the carbohydrate in liver and muscle. And this may not be completely normal in people with type 1 diabetes. There are all the other hormones that are normally co-released with insulin, like amylin, that are not released and have specific functions, and we're not getting those in people with type 1. And you may actually also have some blunting of your normal glucose raising hormones. So the idea is to euglycemia here, where insulin goes down and the hormones go up and you stay balanced, but you easily could go the other ways. And one thing I want to mention in particular, something called hypoglycemia associated autonomic function. I'm forgetting, it's too early in the morning for me. Anyway, what happens is that you have a blunted response. In fact, they believe now that the glucagon response to hypoglycemia and exercise may actually be impacted in people with type 1 diabetes. And what they've shown in studies is if they've been low before, they don't have a normal response to getting to exercising, or if they've exercised before, they may have a blunted response to the next time they get hypoglycemia. So that makes it really hard. A lot of people will be more prone to getting hypoglycemia later on. And so there are going to be some differences if you're competing versus practicing, how much glycogen you start out with and use, timing. If you do it in the morning, it's different in the afternoon. Whether you're trained or untrained, I mentioned the environment, hormonal cycles with females. But the good thing is the benefit. There are many benefits to physical fitness in people with type 1 diabetes. Again, these are all athletes performing with type 1 diabetes. So to sum up here, I would say that, oh, it's great and it would have saved my relatives. Insulin is far from a miracle cure as it was advertised when it was first discovered 100 years ago. People still have to spend every minute of every day pretty much figuring out how to manage their blood glucose to stay in an optimal target range. Many people have severe hypoglycemia. They have diabetic ketoacidosis from hyperglycemia. So there are some things on the horizon that may help integrating systems with, but still limited by the problems that technologies have. Dr. Scott will talk some more about that, and exercise is a challenge to these systems. But having insulin is certainly better than not having insulin, but we really need still better management tools and a real cure. And despite all that, I have been active myself with type 1 diabetes for 53 years, and I strongly advise it for living long and well with diabetes. I just want to mention the book that I wrote recently, the Athlete's Guide to Diabetes. I actually have several hundred athletes who gave me their feedback on what they do for different types of activities and how they manage them. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sherry, for this excellent presentation. So over to Sam now. Please start your presentation. Looking forward to it.
Okay, so hopefully you can see my slides. Yeah. Okay, so thank you. It's really good to be here, although virtually. In this presentation, I'm going to give an overview of some of the experience that we've gained by working with professional athletes living with type 1 diabetes, and give an overview of some of the challenges that they face both in competition and also in training. And then also the ways in which we have been using research to better understand the ways in which this unique group are achieving what they are achieving. And also how we can apply this research to everybody else living with type 1 diabetes as well. And perhaps also particularly of interest to this audience, because I know that not so many people here would perhaps know or have experience with type 1 diabetes, but how that can also be applied to all other athletes, particularly in cycling. So I wanted to start off by restating what I think is an interesting fact that Sherry touched upon in her presentation, with that there's just 4 grams of glucose that's circulating the blood of a person without diabetes at any one time. And this is equivalent to just 1 teaspoon. So if you can imagine the entire circulation, this is a really small amount, and the amount of control that's required to maintain this is very sophisticated. This 4 grams is important because glucose is the primary fuel source for the brain, and without it you would quickly experience hypoglycemia, coma, and in extreme cases potentially even death. But on the other hand, prolonged or recurrent exposure to raised blood glucose levels leads to tissue damage throughout the body. So things like vascular damage, nerve damage. And so this is also important to balance, so that you're not experiencing too much time in hyperglycemia. So in order to control this small small amount of glucose throughout the circulation, a very sophisticated control mechanism is in place. And in healthy individuals, these tight control mechanisms exist in order to maintain blood glucose within around 4 to 8 millimoles per litre. But particularly what we're interested in as researchers is exercise. And as you'll see, so Sherry went through this in her presentation, exercise presents a lot of challenges that stress these systems. So just to give you a brief overview of the way in which glucose is managed hormonally in an individual without diabetes. So if we first go through mild or moderate intensity exercise, so aerobic level exercise of around 60-70% VO2 max. What happens here is that endogenous insulin will actually decrease the production from the pancreas, and you'll probably get an increase in glucagon as well, which is the hormone which causes an increase in glucose release from the liver. And these hormones help to maintain blood glucose concentration within that normal range of around 5 millimoles per litre. If we think about intense or anaerobic exercise, so something nearer 100% of VO2 max, what you get here actually is an increase in catecholamine release, so epinephrine, norepinephrine, and this causes a release of glucose from the liver. And in order to manage this, the pancreas will tend to increase insulin production probably after the bout of exercise, as it's shorter in duration during this type of exercise. All the time, this is aiming to maintain that normal blood glucose concentration. If we contrast this to somebody living with type 1 diabetes, during mild intensity exercise, you've got those contractions that Sherry touched upon, which are going to cause a decrease in glucose. But at the same time, you actually have no change in insulin because the insulin isn't coming from the pancreas. It's being delivered exogenously. So it means you'll either get no change or even an increase in insulin. And glucagon won't increase either. This means that you'll get a decrease in blood glucose concentration. On the other hand, if you're doing intense or anaerobic exercise, you'll still get that increase in catecholamines because this response to exercise is still intact. And this will actually lead to an increase in blood glucose concentration and can lead to hyperglycemia. So in general, what this means is that you see these trends, these different types of trends during, depending on the type of exercise that you've done. So this is kind of a simplified overview here, but in general, somebody with type 1 diabetes will tend to see a decrease in blood glucose concentration when they do a prolonged bout of aerobic exercise. So something like going for a 30-minute run or a cycle. During more mixed type exercise, like sports, such where a more intermittent, like playing football or basketball, you might see more of a steady type of response in your blood glucose because you've got this mix of low intensity mixed with higher intensity bouts where you've got these increases in catecholamines. And finally, with anaerobic exercise, so something like resistance training, or sprinting, you can see very large increases in glucose. This is the general trend. It's kind of simplified because, as Sherry said as well, there's also all those numerous factors that can add on top of this to influence glucose. So, for example, the amount of insulin that you've already got within your circulation, whether you've done a prior bout of exercise and your increased risk of recurrent hyperglycemia, the temperature, and then all kinds of additional physiological factors, nutrition, that kind of thing. So what we're interested in primarily is professional road cycling. So professional road cycling is one of the most demanding sports, combining high levels of exercise duration, intensity, and frequency. It's a high volume of training, long seasons, and very frequent number of race days. Combined with this, an athlete has tight racing schedules, so there's the travel time between race days, and also frequent domestic and international flights. This includes the toll that jet lag can take on the athletes as they travel to the races. And then if you combine these challenges of doing professional road cycling with type 1 diabetes, you have this monumental task of managing glycemia alongside all the other challenges of being a competitive athlete. But despite the challenges, Team Novo Nordisk are an example of a sports team that are competing at the very top level while living with type 1 diabetes. So who are type 1 Team Novo Nordisk? So Team Novo Nordisk are the first all diabetes professional cycling team. The entire team consists of athletes living and racing with type 1 diabetes. And what you will see here on the slide is that they're wearing these nice new jerseys with the big 100 on the back. And this is to celebrate the fact that we are in the 100 year anniversary of insulin. And that's what this presentation is about. And this team kind of demonstrates how far things have come and what is possible. And cycling is just one example, I think, that the team represents that anything can still be achieved, whether it's in work, academia, or in sport, while living with type 1 diabetes, provided that there's careful management and planning. So Team Novo Nordisk, we have the men's pro team, and we also have some development teams, and there's a number of track cyclists as well. But the main team that we work with is the men's professional road cycling team. This consists of 17 riders at the moment, aged between 20 and 36 years. On our team, we have a very international team. These riders come from all over the world. So we have examples from New Zealand, Switzerland, France. Currently, we have the Finnish road cycling champion. That's why his jersey here is highlighted differently. Riders from Australia, Spain, Hungary, and I could go on. There's also lots of differences within the team. The duration of the amount of time that the riders have lived with and have experience of type 1 diabetes is very wide ranging. So from as few as 2 years up to 18 years. In terms of treatment, two riders are currently on insulin pumps, and all of the other riders are using multiple daily injections. This isn't necessarily right or wrong, it's just personal choice. And there's a lot of the riders in the development team who are using closed loop systems and insulin pumps as well. So when we started working with the team, the storyline basically was that we thought it was first and foremost, the most important thing was to build a relationship with the riders and also to learn more about them. It was very obvious to us that we had a group with huge experience, both as professional cyclists and also as athletes living with type 1 diabetes. And it's very important for us, before coming in and making any changes, that we understand each of them as an individual, where they are coming from, and what they would like to change, if anything. And as part of this, I think it's important that you build these relationships by talking to the athletes and trying to understand their perspective. And this is important for trust and understanding, so that any change that you want to make or any research that you want to implement is done with kind of their benefit in mind all of the time, but also understanding each person as an individual and not applying a one-size-fits-all approach at any point. So I think I can give an example of that, and I think it's really important. And I could have chosen any of the athletes from the team, but I've decided to choose these two just to show you how big of a contrast there are between some of the athletes on the team. So here I've highlighted Mandy Marquardt. She's actually a track cyclist, so she competes in the velodrome. She's a sprinter. She represents the United States and also Team Novo Nordisk. She actually holds at the moment the 1 kilometer time trial, and this is for any athlete, all athletes as well, including not living with type 1 diabetes. And she was unfortunate on just missing out on representing the US at the Olympic Games this summer. Mandy was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at the age of 16. So from a perspective of understanding her, you will have very large differences from the men's professional team. Hormones will be very different, and this is likely to differ depending on stage of the menstrual cycle, for example. Also the intensity at which she's training and competing, and the number of times per day that she's competing. She's likely to compete more than once per day, whereas the road cycling team are competing only once per day. And in contrast to Mandy, I've highlighted here Peter Kuster. So Peter is currently 36 years old, and he turned pro in 2005. He is a very experienced rider. He actually raced 14 seasons, I think it was, before he was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And during that time, he represented Hungary at the Olympic Games. He was Hungarian national road racing champion. But the reason I've highlighted him because he was actually diagnosed quite late in comparison to most of the other riders on the team. So he has a lot of experience as a professional cyclist and probably one of the most experienced guys on the team. But in terms of experience of living with type 1 diabetes, it's much less in time compared to some of the other athletes who have been diagnosed before the age of 10. So I think it's important to understand these differences and speak to these guys in order to understand that when you're researching, that you don't just group everyone together and take the mean response or apply any of your changes to everyone and expect it to make a difference. And the way in which we've been looking into this in terms of developing these relationships and also learning about these guys, besides from talking to them and having lots of interviews with them, we've collected data through questionnaires. We thought it was important to design certain questionnaires focusing on key areas related to both type 1 diabetes and also professional road cycling. On a very broad level, what we focused on was sleep, nutrition, technology. This includes both cycling technology and also diabetes technology, and also glucose management. In addition to this work that we can do through speaking to the riders, we're very lucky at the moment to have a lot of very advanced technology that means that we can conduct research in a very non-invasive way and also remotely while the athletes are actually competing in race situations without interfering with their schedules in any way. So for example, some of the technology that we have available to us and have been using in our research includes continuous glucose monitors, so we can track their glucose both during races, outside of races, and this includes overnight as well. We can capture insulin dosing data through both smart insulin pens and also the readouts from their insulin pumps if they're using those. We are working on developing technology to look at in-ride nutrition. This is something that needs more work, but advancements are being made at a rapid rate, and this will be very important for us, and it also is very important for people who research athletes without diabetes as well. We have access to cycling data as well from the exercise that they've been doing. So standard things such as heart rate, energy expenditure, power output from cycling computers. We can look at race day characteristics such as elevation gain, distance covered, temperature. And as we mentioned earlier, the more that we can understand about the environment and the external factors that are going on in addition to the type of timing of exercise, the better that we can build up a picture of what's going on with these guys in order to better inform both our research and the feedback that the athletes are receiving so that they can change their behaviors accordingly. So to give an example of where we've used this, I'll briefly go through a study that we conducted through the Tour of California. So this was a world tour race over 7 days. Here we studied seven professional riders from Team Novo Nordisk. And here I've drawn out a map of California. As you can see, they were covering very large distances every day, between 3 and 6 hours of cycling, between 126 to 218 kilometers per day, with almost 21,000 meters of elevation. In addition to this, there's lots of logistical challenges, and anybody else who's worked with professional cyclists will know that this is nowhere near as easy as just waking up in your own bed and going out for a bike ride. These kind of things are really like a moving circus. You wake up in one hotel, you have to pack as quickly as possible, you're in the back of the truck ready to the race start. Then they have to be prepared, nutrition has to be sorted, race day preparation. Then as soon as the race finishes, back in the truck onto the next hotel. I was following the race throughout this. I was exhausted and I didn't do any cycling. So I can only imagine how hard it is for these athletes who are then cycling up to 6 hours during this time. But despite these challenges, during this particular race, Team Novo were quite successful. They won. One of the riders with the most courageous rider jersey on day one of the tour. There was top 20 result, top 10, and there was a number of breakaways as well. So in terms of what we found, this was the first time we had investigated athletes living with type 1 diabetes during such a race. We found that they were consuming a lot of carbohydrates during the races. So on average, 76 grams per hour. And this is in line with what you would expect for other athletes that they were competing with without type 1 diabetes. And interestingly, despite the huge amounts of carbohydrates that they're ingesting, there's not many instances in which they're injecting insulin during the race. So this really just highlights the power of exercise and how important those contraction-based glucose uptake into the muscles is. In terms of what we saw on the continuous glucose monitor data, this is the CGM data from each day of the Tour of California. The green represents time in target, so euglycemia, that target range that Sherry mentioned. Anything in red is time below or hypoglycemia, and anything in the yellow or orange is time above target. As you can see, remarkably, despite the amount of cycling that they're doing, that amount of time, there's a very large amount of time in which they're spent in target glucose range and almost no time below target range over the entire course of the tour. So these riders are very very good at keeping their glucose within range while they're cycling in these races. One thing that stood out for us, which was potentially concerning and also interesting at the same time that we were able to highlight to the team, which was we noticed this pattern of increasing levels of hypoglycemia overnight. And this highlighted for us a need to look more into the post-exercise period, perhaps the refueling after the races wasn't adequate, or maybe insulin dosage was a bit high afterwards. So This is something that we've been working on and looking into with our research more and more. So as we've mentioned a lot, living with type 1 diabetes is challenging, and also being a competitive athlete is challenging. And we've been more and more trying to map out the challenges of both so that we can pinpoint where and how we can most appropriately help the athletes to increase time in range and also hopefully increase performance along the way. So just from this slide, you can see how busy an athlete's life is, where they're trying to manage things related to fueling, training, and also commitments related to things like meetings and media. And then you double that or even more with all of the diabetes related challenges or decisions you have to make alongside that the athletes that they're competing with just don't have to think about. One thing that I thought was really interesting to highlight was some of the key discoveries that have happened over the last 100 years in terms of type 1 diabetes, technology and medicine in relation to sport. And as Sherry mentioned, the discovery of insulin was by no means the end of the story. What we've seen has been this great advancement where almost with every decade, we're seeing newer and better types of insulins, technology, and all of these things are helping people to live life a bit easier and also to be more accurate, be more active. Alongside this, what we've noticed as well is that there's more and more athletes who are actually competing at the top level, showing us what they're capable of. So as you can see here on the slide, there were a few athletes who were doing very well in sport, but this slide gets much more busy as we look towards the more recent decades, where we have technologies such as continuous glucose monitoring, faster acting insulins, and we can probably expect this to increase more and more as we see these technologies increase further in the future. We actually had a few athletes living with type 1 diabetes competing at these Olympics over the summer. Something that's increasingly being important both for athletes without type 1 diabetes and those living with type 1 diabetes is this integration of data and looking at ways in which the user can get the most out of what is being fed in, whether this includes continuous glucose monitor, food logging, nutrition, activity. This is more and more being put together and algorithms are being developed so that decision support tools can better inform the user on how they should adapt their insulin, or indeed how it automatically adapts itself if they're using closed loop systems, or how they can better inform their nutrition or training practices. And here I thought it was very important to highlight my friend and colleague Federico Fontana, who's head of performance at Team Novo Nordisk, and I think he's one of the driving forces behind this research with Team Novo Nordisk and putting these data sets together so that the athletes can be better informed about the decisions that they should make for their training and also glucose management. So part of what we've been working on is looking to visualize, better inform the riders and the athletes visually in a better way that they can understand it. So here I have an example of cycling data, where you can see elevation gain shown in the gray here, heart rate data shown in the red, and also power. And overlapping that, you have the glucose. So we can start looking ways in which the riders could perhaps adjust their decisions based on past experiences so that they can better inform their training and racing for the future. And key things that we've been working on has been remote monitoring and support, both for training and glucose management of the riders through using these data. We've been working on ways to make this easier to understand through visualization. So here is actually an example of something that FedE created, which is quite visually appealing so that the rider can start to feel more connected with their cycling data and also their glucose data. And more in the future, I think a lot of groups in various labs are looking at the development of personalized machine learning to look at both the risk of glycemia and dysglycemia, sorry, in people living with type 1 diabetes. And also, I know that in sports science in general, this has been used to monitor risk of injury as well. Finally, I thought that something that I would just touch on briefly, because I know that a lot of the audience in this conference perhaps won't be so aware of type 1 diabetes, but they work with cyclists and have experience with glucose and may have also heard about increasingly people without diabetes wanting to monitor their glucose. So we have some preliminary data, and it's very important to stress that this isn't verified at all. More information is needed to back up whether this is actually true and to look at the hormones. But this is just one example, which was taken by somebody who competed, who completed what's called the Everesting Challenge. So this is a challenge where you have to cycle the equivalent of Mount Everest in a single setting. And it can be on Zwift, or it can be on a mountain where you go back and forth, with the idea of accumulating almost 9,000 meters of elevation. So this particular individual took 7 hours to do it. And during this time, they wore a continuous glucose monitor to see what would happen. So this is a person without diabetes. And what we can see in this trace is that before the exercise, their glucose was quite stable at around 5 millimoles per liter. But during the exercise bout, their glucose increased very sharply and actually stayed very high for 7 hours. So this is the exercise bout. So this is a 7 hour period. And then just briefly, this is the food that they ate. So very high carbohydrate intake during the 7 hours. And as I say, more information is needed to verify whether this is actually true and whether it's being driven by the carbohydrates or whether it's the exercise itself. So it raises more questions than answers. Again, just to reiterate, this is just one example, although we do have some others. We need to look more into the hormonal response here. So to conclude, it is definitely possible to compete at a professional level while living with type 1 diabetes. And Team Novo Nordisk are just one example of that. There are many other people who have done this. It's important to consider the athletes as human beings and be willing to learn from them. We found that we learn more by listening to them than we ever could from just applying what we've read in textbooks. They have a huge wealth of knowledge that I think is important to gain from. Try and target sensible areas for improvement rather than looking for what you think might be the most fancy way to have an impact. Sometimes just solving the basics, whether it's sleep or nutrition, have quite an important benefit. And technology is increasingly helping us to optimize training, nutrition plans, and also glucose management here. And finally, we look forward to the next 100 years of innovation, because it seems to be coming along faster and faster all the time. So thank you for listening. I'll hand it back to Anton.
Thanks very much, Sam, for again an excellent presentation, two excellent presentations. So we have some time for questions, not a lot anymore, but all the presentations were very clear, so we've learned a lot from it. So I want to start with one question. So I understand, Sherry, that you were diagnosed with type 1 diabetes as a child. Can you describe whether this has led to major changes in your experience of early life? And a couple to that is, were you encouraged by your parents to take up sport activities to increase physical activity levels, basically? And are you still physically active today? And does this help you to cope with the type 1 diabetes?
So interestingly, I think I was referred to when I was diagnosed with diabetes. I was actually 4 years old, 1968, as the dark ages in diabetes. And I realized there are worse times, but it's because there was actually no way to monitor blood glucose then. And so you imagine I went all through growing up in high school sports and stuff and never had a blood glucose meter, had no way to change my insulin and regulate it. And so I was not a great athlete, but I was always a willing participant. There were just some days I felt horrible and some days I didn't. And my parents actually were a little afraid to have me exercise because I would have these unexplained lows or unexplained highs. It was confusing for them because there were so few tools to work with. So I feel actually so fortunate now to have all these tools to have instantaneous feedback to get. I seldom complain about being able to know what my glucose is at this point. So I think a lot of that really did actually influence what I did. I remember when I was younger that I always felt better when I would be physically active, just physically. And then I also mentally felt more in, like I was in control of my diabetes, even though I probably wasn't. I felt so much better. And you know, you have all these mental health benefits from being active, whether you have diabetes or not. And so I kind of followed in on my own. My parents didn't encourage it at all because they just were overwhelmed with trying to figure out what to do. I actually remember reading what there was back. I graduated from high school in 1981. So when I was in high school, reading all the things about complications and leg amputations and kidney failures, I'd actually convinced myself reading all that, that I was going to die from diabetes before I even made it out of high school. So I've actually come a long ways, 40 years since then. And I have been physically active my entire life by choice. And as I got a meter, my first meter I got when I was in my early 20s, and I found that it's a huge learning curve. Everything's a learning curve. So, you know, what Sam was mentioning that they learned from these athletes is just amazing stuff that we have that kind of feedback for them. I don't think that when I developed diabetes that there could have been anyone who could have competed at that level, because there just wasn't that kind of information where, you know, if you're too low, you really can't compete. And if you're too high, you really can't compete. When it shows, you know, a person without a diabetes going up to 10 millimolar during training, I mean, can you imagine being three times that? And then you feel sluggish and gross and whatever. So, I think it's part of the reason why I became an exercise physiologist. I was just so interested in why exercise made me feel so much better and so much more in control of my type 1 diabetes.
Thanks very much. Question for Sam. Do your elite cyclists develop their own personal strategy to maintain glucose homeostasis, especially during events like the Tour of California, or do they share experience and do they develop common strategies which work for several or most of the riders, are the strategies different for each individual rider? Christophe, when you want to jump in, please jump in the answer as well. But first, to you, Sam.
Yeah, so it is very different. One of the questions we were asking, like on those questionnaires, was where the riders go to for information on diabetes management, and we were asking whether they look for advice from their peers on the team, whether they go to the things like the internet, or whether they speak to their diabetes education educator or endocrinologist. And it was very interesting from those findings. They do speak to each other a lot. They do discuss different strategies, what works well for one and what doesn't work so well. They're also in close conversation with their diabetes educator and their own personal endocrinologist. But they can only transfer so much from each other because their requirements are very different. The insulin dose that each rider requires is massively different, maybe fivefold different from one rider to another sometimes. The amount of time in which some riders have had diabetes makes a huge difference. So for example, some riders are probably producing some of their own insulin because of the amount of time that they've been diagnosed. If type 1 diabetes is relatively recent, so they don't require as much insulin compared to some of the others that definitely don't produce their own insulin. And as I said, there's some riders who are actually using insulin pumps, so the requirements there will be different as well. So it's really a mix. The riders tend to develop a strategy that works for them, and then they will have a routine. I think routine is very important, and when that routine gets disrupted, that's when the challenges occur. But unfortunately, with professional cycling, disruption of routine is constantly being forced upon them. Maybe Christoph, you have something you would add.
Thank you, Sam. I mean, I couldn't agree more. And back to your question, Anton, there is probably now enough evidence. You have heard how broad the spectrum is, that there is no single, you know, individual therapy applicable to everyone, but there is a need for personalized approaches to athletes, but also actually to each and every patient with type 1 diabetes. And this encompasses pharmacotherapy. So you heard about insulin now. We have seen that pens get smarter. You can even connect pens now and use them within at least adapted closed loop systems. We have the pumps, as Sherry has shown us nicely, and we use them now more and more together with algorithms. And as Sam said, we now have more and more athletes using these hybrid or closed loop systems and really revealing, you know, curves like non-diabetic individuals, really flat curves, which hasn't been possible 10 years ago, and even less so 20 or 30 years ago. So there has been massive game changes. We have these sensors measuring glucose, as you have been seeing, but more and more we also measure, you know, differing parameters, not only glucose, ketones, lactate. We combine that. We even use sensor inputs from bicycles, for instance, in the professional athletes. We can use sensors from cars, for instance, in non-athletes with type 1 diabetes, you know, to conceive the situation, dangerousness of a situation when driving cars, it's a predicting hypoglycemia, so including sensor data from videos, from differing inputs, combining in algorithms. We have this technology now. I think we should challenge dogmas more and more. So for instance, in athletes, we use more and more alternative carbohydrates. So fructose has always been seen as a bad guy in diabetes, obviously, but for type 1 diabetic individuals, for instance, we've shown that in variant studies now that fructose is an excellent carbohydrate, adding to classical, you know, saccharose and glucose. So adding to that, we use mini glucagons, very low doses. We use alternative pharmacotherapy, SGLT2 inhibitors from type 2 diabetes. So there's a variety of things that you can combine in the end to come up with individualized, personalized treatment for these athletes, for patients with type 1 diabetes.
Yeah, you all mentioned closed loop systems. So is there a closed loop system for everybody, for inactive people, active people, for the top cyclists, or do you see a future, or do you see developments in the future that will make the closed loop systems really suitable for the majority of the type 1 diabetes people with type 1 diabetes, whatever their physical fitness is? Who wants to start?
Well, actually, I have a clear opinion on that, and I'm pretty sure when it's available, and I mean, we know that, you know, availability is not guaranteed all over the planet right now, but when these systems are available, and as Sherry has shown, there are several on the market, Sherry has shown too, there are even more now available on the market, and as we use them more and more, and as the algorithms get better and better, and they learn, we see, you know, treatment outcomes simply not being possible a few years back. So I'm pretty sure that this is going to be at least a huge part of the future in type 1 diabetes. Whereas, of course, the challenges of, you know, healing the disease, treating the fundamental problem should go on. But as far as I can see, I think the chances for our patients to have a direct impact, beneficial impact on the treatment, is much higher on the technological side. So yes, I think closed loops, they will be a very important part for at least the next future.
Next question. My understanding is that people living with type 1 diabetes are advised to inject insulin in the abdominal subcutaneous adipose tissue layers or the subcutaneous layers of an upper arm or a leg. And Stem told me yesterday that the elite cyclist he is working with, they inject insulin in the upper arm muscles before they start cycling. This then leads to the question, why is this choice of this site? Is it different for different populations, the active ones and the inactive ones? Anybody?
Okay. I'll start. There were some early studies that actually showed the absorption was different from different tissues, probably just because of the general perfusion of blood through those areas. I would say personally, I have noticed that there's a big difference even in different parts of my abdomen versus other places. So what we've always advised athletes without a lot of data to back it up is that they not give insulin in an area that's above an active muscle. So maybe in the cyclists, for example, they do upper arm because their legs are going to be doing most of the work and their arms aren't going to be doing as much. Anywhere where you're super active, you also increase the skin blood flow, and that, for depending on the type of insulin, can speed up the absorption, and then that really messes up what you're trying to figure out. So it may be simply just trying to avoid putting it where you're going to be super active. I personally just use my abdomen, it's easiest.
Okay. More comments?
No, I agree with Sherry. I think the main difference will be if they inject directly in the muscle, that will certainly make a difference. And if you want to be really fast, you inject directly in the vein, which is not very suitable for an athlete on a bike, of course, but we have patients doing that. And we do it in the hospital, of course, so that's making a huge difference. But apart from that, there's probably not a big difference, whereas in the abdomen.
A question also on my list. So I shortened all a little bit, so I had hoped that we had more time for discussion, but not too much left. So how effective are the most recent combinations of fast-acting insulin to include you? Acutely reduce our blood glucose and slow-acting insulin to keep blood glucose low for 24 hours? And that is the question for sedentary and moderately active individuals, and for Sherry and probably and Christoph, of course, and also for Sam's elite cycling team. So do they use these combinations also?
I'd say nowadays almost everybody's advised to use some kind of a basal bolus regimen where they cover their background needs with basal, and then they cover food intake with mealtime insulin or rapid acting insulin. However, as Sam showed with his athletes, many of them don't actually take any insulin at all, except I'm assuming they're still taking basal. They've got background insulin on board, but they don't take any insulin to cover the food because the contractions themselves are allowing them to take up the glucose that's coming from that food. So it gives people an option and different tools in terms of you always have to have some insulin in your body. But it allows you to reduce that amount to be much more physiologically normal by having that combination. It's much different than the earlier insulins.
Okay. So I think because at 6 o'clock the next session is starting, I'm going to ask the last question now. Today, and it will be a question to Christoph. Today there are many alternative and complementary therapies to insulin and insulin analogs directed at the management of hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia in people living with type 1 diabetes. So this applies both to non-athletes and athletes, but most of these alternative compounds, they have been developed in the last 5 to 10 years. And therefore, the number of permutations of various combinations of these agents must be staggering. So I therefore want to direct ask you, Christoph, how do you and your clinical colleagues at the University of Bern aiming to design the optimum therapy regimen for any given individual with type 1 diabetes? How will you deal with so many potential choices and combinations?
Yeah, it's a difficult question, but actually you can also put it the other way around. You know, the increasing, you know, opportunity and options that we have, they give us more tools to, you know, the caregivers, to the patients, their family. So as I said before, there is no single treatment for an individual with type 1 diabetes, but it needs to be personalized. This refers to pharmacotherapy, this refers to the technology, this, and then in the end also refers to the human factor, actually, because I mean, you know, treating and following people with type 1 diabetes is also coaching, and this not only refers to athletes or active people, to actually everyone with type 1 diabetes. This is a lifelong coaching that we together will do over years and decades. And the pandemic has shown, you know, also, you know, the chances of telemedicine, of course, increasing importance. And our group, actually, together with Sam, we have analyzed the role of telemedicine over the pandemic, and we have seen that this has been increasingly adopted by high percentage, high acceptance. But then we have also seen that there's an increasing wish now, more and more, to, and maybe also an increasing need to at least combine telemedicine with face-to-face consultation. So in addition to all the huge developments that we have, you know, treatment, medication, technology, the human aspects, they will probably always be essential in the care of people with type 1 diabetes. And I think that this is true personalized medicine in the end.
Yeah. Okay. So there's a great future for all the patients, basically. That's your conclusion. Okay. So thanks to the audience for being with us. Thanks very much to the speakers and for Christoph getting involved also in the discussions. I think we had a great session. We have learned a lot from it. So thanks all, and maybe see you another time in the future. Okay, thanks all, and goodbye.